believe it or not, the guys on the bench can't get you points. Again, everyone, welcome to another video. Today we're going to be doing the start bench recommendations and the free agency recommendation video or advice video. I made this list a few days ago as of the time I'm recording this. I'm currently recording this on October 28th going into the 29th in about 20 minutes here. But either way, I'll try to get this out by tomorrow morning. But I just want to say, if you just made a trade, so basically Justin Likes Kids, Pussy, Big Yawners, and Mr. Steeler Girl, I'm probably not really going to recommend that you actually start your players, just because I didn't have them on the list whenever I was making my list for this. So I just wanted to let you guys know that. The people I do have recommendations for are going to be Pussy, MILF, Booty Basher. I still am going to have some recommendations for Big Yawners overall, Karen's Husband, Justin Likes Kids overall as well, Scrambled and Wiggle Waggled. And I believe that's it for this week. So if your name was not mentioned there, for example, like Toxic Mr. Steeler Girl, you do not have any recommendations. I guess we'll see you guys in the, free agency part of the video, but we'll kick things off with the recommendations here. With Pussy, I have one recommendation for Pussy, and that is that you start Danielle Hunter and that you bench, Legarius Sneed. What I'm saying to do here is basically put Dax Hill in at the Legarius Sneed DB spot and then toss Danielle Hunter in. The Packers have, I know in theory, not given up that many points to left outside linebackers and left ends. However, they haven't really gone against any good ones. They've gone against two good ones, and I believe that was against Max Crosby, and that was against Aiden Hutchinson, both of which put up over 20 points against the Packers right tackle. I do think it's going to be a pretty good matchup for Danielle Hunter, especially compared to San Fran in the last week. He's been pretty damn good pretty much all season. He might not be insane, like 30 points. Heck, he does have the upside too. But even if he doesn't, I definitely think at this point in time, I would trust it over a guy like Legarius Sneed, who has had 3 weeks now with less than 10 points. And at this point, his ceiling is pretty much Danielle Hunter's week-to-week basis. I definitely think I trust Danielle Hunter over Legarius Sneed, especially for this week. Maybe it depends on the matchups coming up, but I do think this is a very good matchup for Danielle Hunter, and I definitely recommend Pussy starts Danielle Hunter and benches Legarius Sneed. And I didn't give you any advice last week, so we'll move on to the next guy. Next one is MILF. MILF, bear with me. I got quite a few recommendations for you, buddy. First of all, I recommend you start Gardner Minshew. And I recommend you bench Bryce Young. Bryce Young has not shown any sort of upside outside of the game against Detroit, and that was because and only because he was down by a million and got some garbage time points. Outside of that, he has shown literally no upside in fantasy. 10 points, around 10 points per game. Yeah, overall, in the few games Minshew's played, at least he's a veteran, and at least he kind of knows what he's doing with the ball. And he's outscoring Bryce Young consistently in the games he is playing. Plus, he has a better offense all around the board, where he has Jonathan Taylor, Michael Pittman, better O-line, you name it. I'm overall just liking Gardner Minshew a lot more. Sure, he's playing a tougher matchup, but either way, I still think he'll get a lot more points than Bryce Young. I recommend you start Logan Thomas, and I recommend you bench Brandon Cooks. Logan Thomas has had a few off weeks, mostly just the one, but he could have had way more points week two, but he got hurt after catching the touchdown. He had the bad week against Atlanta, but other than that, he's been a pretty consistent option, pretty damn good throughout the whole year that he's been playing in. One of the more consistent options out of any tight end in the league, to be honest. And he also does occasionally have that upside to pop off like he did against the Bears, but I think 10 points is more realistic overall. Brandon Cooks is just done nothing this year. You can see by his 30 points. He had the one good week against the Chargers. Yippee ki yay, I guess. 4 catches for 36 yards, a touchdown salvages it, but he has not had a single actual good week. He's had some mediocre weeks, and that's the best I can give him. Either way, I think 9 times out of 10, Logan Thomas is probably going to outscore him this season, and I would definitely recommend going with Logan Thomas for this specific week. Then, for MILF, I would also recommend you start Seattle's defense and you bench Miami's. Now, I know Miami is doing pretty solid this year so far, don't get me wrong. And they are playing against a weak Patriots offense. However, they are playing a Browns offense that might be missing not only Deshaun Watson, not only Nick Chubb, they might be missing Jerome Ford, and Kareem Hunt's going to be playing through an injury more likely than not. This offense is fucking mutilated. I think it's going to be hard to say that this Browns offense is going to be able to put up over 20 points against Seattle. It's just very hard for me to picture, at least. At least last week you had the argument of the run game, which was able to keep him in it. But I just can't see it. I think putting Seattle in is going to be a lot safer of an option. And they've been actually outperforming Miami for the most part outside of week one this season. Especially now that they have Jamal Adams back. I think their defense is looking pretty good, and I do think I trust them more than Miami for this specific week. Then we'll go right ahead and look at the defensive part of things. I recommend you start Grant Delpit and bench Shaq Leonard. Now, what I'd basically say to do is put Nate Landman in at your linebacker position for Shaq Leonard, move Shaq Leonard to the D spot, then put Grant Delpit at the D spot. Grant Delpit has been pretty consistent this year. He had one bad week. He had a bye week. Other than that, he's had three pretty great weeks, and then a mediocre week, well, two if you count the 11 week. But overall, he's getting good tackles. He's getting good playmaker. Excuse me. He's making good plays. He's definitely been a hell of a lot more consistent than Shaquille Leonard, that's for sure, who only has 60 points. He's just been mediocre across the board, bad for a linebacker standard. This isn't the same guy he used to be. Zaire Franklin is taking every fucking tackle, and if not him, Julian Blackman. If not him, then Kwity Paye. If not him, then Grover Stewart. There's so many tacklers on this team. If not him, then Kenny Moore. Like, everybody else on this team is going to be eating up more tackles than this guy. It's almost impossible to say that you can trust him on a fantasy point of view. Do not be tricked by his projection. I would go Grant Delpit here because at least he's had a floor of around 10 points per game, plus he always has that upside. I definitely recommend going with Delpit there. Other than that, I believe that's all I have for you in terms of your recommendations, MILF. Yeah, that was quite a bit, so if there might be a lot to review. It's up to you if you plan on taking any of the decisions or not for it. Next up for, let's see here. I think we're going to go into Booty next. Yeah, we're going to go to Booty. I recommend you start Christian McCaffrey and that you bench Jaylen Warren. Now, Jaylen Warren is not bad in the slightest. I'm not saying he's bad. I'm not saying he's not startable. But when your other option is Christian McCaffrey, you take Christian McCaffrey. I do not give a fuck who the other option is. I don't care if it's prime Barry Sanders. I don't care if it's prime fucking Reggie Bush, you name it. I don't care if it's Walter Payton. You take Christian McCaffrey in fantasy every single time. The situation is ridiculously good for him. He's going to get a lot of targets. He's going to get touchdowns. He's going to get yards. He's going to do everything. You always take that. There's just no debate to it. Then if you're Booty, I also recommend you start Derrick Henry and bench DeAndre Swift. I know DeAndre Swift has done pretty consistent and pretty well this season. However, I will warn you, against Washington, he did have 17.9, but 6 of it was off of a touchdown, so he was held off of having a mediocre week from the touchdown, which definitely made his stats seem a bit better. I do recommend keeping in Henry, just because all season, with the exception of the week against Cleveland, he's pretty much outplayed DeAndre Swift every week. He had a mediocre week 5, but either way, he's definitely had those insane high upside games, where he's making a lot of plays happen, getting a lot of yards, occasionally getting touchdowns. I think Henry's a lot safer of an option where he's not touchdown reliant. Plus, he just has a better matchup overall because Atlanta does have some good pass defenders. But they do have a good run defense for what it's worth, but so does Washington. So I definitely think I'd prefer Derrick Henry. And I'd also recommend you start Cincinnati's defense and bench Green Bay. Well, actually, I think I'd change that pick thinking about it, because whenever I made that, I actually made that assuming that Brock Purdy would probably be out, but I do think that that's since changed. So I actually think I'd change that pick and keep Green Bay in. I don't like either of these for this week. I'd actually recommend you look at someone on free agency if you're watching this, but either way, I would actually keep Green Bay in, so just keep that or that suggestion in the books. Last week, I recommended that you started George Pickens and bench D-Hop. This would have earned you 15.7 points. I recommended you started Jaylen Warren and bench Derrick Henry. This would have earned you 10.10. And I recommended you started Green Bay and bench Cincinnati. This would have earned you 13.85 for a combined total of 39.65 points. It was all just because the players that I told you to bench were on bye week, so I'm not going to go ask for credit for that. Those were pretty obvious. I just figured I'd include it in the video. Then we'll move things on to big yawners. Big yawners. I recommend you start David Long and bench Jermaine Pratt. Jermaine Pratt is not a bad option, don't get me wrong. He has some good upside every week. However, David Long has the same upside as Jermaine Pratt. It might not be as high and as common to hit, say, like 20-25, but at least you know 9 times out of 10 you're going to get 15, and you occasionally have that chance to get even more, that like the number's close to what Jermaine Pratt might get. While Jermaine Pratt will probably have weeks where he gets 10 less sometimes, you know, where he's really not doing much, David Long is going to be a good rock to fall back on to get you those points every single week, while Jermaine Pratt is going to have those off weeks. I definitely think I like David Long overall more than Pratt, just because I do think he'll finish with more total points. Outside of that first week where he was barely playing, he's just done phenomenal. Ignore that 8-point week where he got taken out early with a concussion. But overall, yeah, I'm definitely a fan of David Long here, and it's also worth mentioning in the games that Jermaine Pratt's played so far this season, the one time they played against an elite running back, he didn't get too many points. He had 13. Just figured that was worth mentioning. And the Dolphins, last time they played the Patriots, David Long went out there and had 8 tackles and a sack. So I definitely do think I prefer David Long in this matchup. And I didn't have any recommendations for you last week. Next up, we'll move on to Karen's husband. I think I mentioned him at the beginning. We'll move on to Karen's husband. With Karen, I recommend you start Zach Wilson, and I recommend you bench Joshua Dobbs. With Zach Wilson, the main reason I would say you should start him is because he's going up against one of the worst defenses in the league, in the Giants. This Giants defense is atrocious around the board, with the exception of 2 defensive linemen. Actually, 3 defensive linemen. Other than that, this whole team is atrocious. Bad corners, bad linebackers, bad safeties, you name it. Pinnock has had a few big plays, but he's still burnt toast 90% of the time. And I do think Zach Wilson will probably be a better bet than Josh Dobbs. I know Dobbs has been outplaying Wilson so far throughout the season, but this is literally the worst matchup he could have all season, where he's going to be playing against the Ravens, who have stacked linebackers, stacked cornerbacks, okay safeties. They have a few pieces on the D-line that have actually been looking better than anyone expected them to, such as Justin Madbuike, as we'll talk about in a bit. I think this is probably the worst matchup he could possibly be fed. I just definitely think I would prefer Zach Wilson here, just because of how much of a drastic difference in matchup that is. Then with Karen's husband, I recommend you start Nico Collins, bench Zach Ertz. I'd say put Cole Kmet in at your tight end and then throw Nico Collins in. We'll get to Tony Pollard in a minute, but for now with Nico Collins, he's been inconsistent, but if he does definitely have the upside to do insanely good on a week-to-week basis, as you saw against Pittsburgh and Indianapolis. Then I would recommend you start Tony Pollard, bench Deontay Foreman. Deontay Foreman, while he did do fantastic last week, he is going to be having to deal with the return of Rashawn Johnson, who's going to be eating away at probably at least a third of his snaps, and most of them will probably be receiving snaps. So I'm not looking too excited about that. I do think right off the bat his upside is going down, and I know the Bears are using Tyson Badgett. However, they are playing against the worst pass defense in the entire league, so I do think they're going to make a conscious effort to absolutely try and use the passing game to their advantage more than they did in the last week. So I definitely do think he's going to, at best, fall back, while Tony Pollard has just been ridiculous all season. When it comes to his points, he had a mediocre week 4 and then a bad week 5, but other than that, the guy's making it work. He's not getting too many yards per carry in terms of real life, but he's getting a shit ton of targets. He had a few rushing touchdowns in the beginning of the season, but if this guy were to start getting touchdowns or something like that, he would be a really good option to have overall. Definitely better than Deontay Foreman. Then we'll look at Justin Likes Kids. With Justin Likes Kids, I recommend you start Garrett Wilson and bench Jameson Williams. Now, Jameson Williams is going to be having a very friendly matchup against a weak Raiders defense this week. You'll hear no argument from me. That is something he'll have going for him. However, he's only had a 3-game sample size in which he failed out of 2 of the 3 tests he's had so far. We had 2 points and 0 points. He had a good week 2 against good second week against Tampa Bay. We had 17.3 with 2 catches on 53 yards and a touchdown. However, I actually regret saying that. That's not even a good week. That's him getting bailed out on a really big play. This guy is not going to be consistent. I would keep him on the bench until he shows you consistency. Especially when your roster is as talented as it is. You don't want to be taking unnecessary shots that can really tank your team. I would take Garrett Wilson, who's playing against a very, very weak defense in the Giants. This will be one of the most friendly matchups he'll have all season. Even when he's been going against these tough matchups, he's been making it work. Getting some good points, getting some good catches for yards. I definitely recommend Garrett Wilson over Jameson Williams, and it's not even close. I can almost promise you Garrett Wilson will have more points in this game. Jaquan Brisker is out, which is kind of what's throwing this off a little bit. Plus, you already played Antoine Winfield. So that kind of threw off my start bench recommendations overall. But I'd say throw in Kaiser White at your linebacker position. And what I was originally going to say was throw in Dre Greenlaw at your Antoine Winfield spot. Throw him in for Jaquan Brisker and then bench Jaquan Brisker. But that's kind of all fucked up now because B-Dog, just did not really set his team yet. But either way, I would definitely find a way to get Dre Greenlaw in there. Don't bench TJ Edwards, though. He's fucking fantastic. These linebackers are all really good if you're B-Dog. If you're Justin Likes Kids, you should probably try to trade some of these guys away, to be honest. Because Devondre Campbell, Dre Greenlaw, Kaiser White, Azeez Al-Shaair, and Nick Bolton, not until the ending of the season. But literally all of these guys are guys that you could find some other team out there that would go in there and start them in a heartbeat. These are all insanely good linebackers. You have a lot of trade value there. You could probably go out there and upgrade maybe either your quarterback position, maybe upgrade it running back, maybe get a combo deal to upgrade a receiver. Something like that you could probably do. You just have so much value here at your linebackers. It would just be something I strongly recommend. And then last week, my recommendations for you were to start Kaiser White and bench Eric. And it was actually to start Kaiser White and to bench Jaquan Brisker. Kaiser White, I believe, had 15. Brisker had 20, so this would have lost you 5 points. Brisker had a really good week. He is projected to start picking up a bigger role, which is good news overall, but I do think keeping Kaiser White in for the rest of the season will still be the wiser decision just because of that crazy consistency. His lowest week was 10 points. His best week was 30. Every week he's had between 10 and 20. This guy has been really good, very consistent option. I would definitely not recommend keeping him on the bench. And I also recommended you start Dre Greenlaw and bench Eric Kendricks. Dre Greenlaw has been fucking redonkulously good in the games that he started and was healthy. He had 21 points last week. And Eric Kendricks has been, it's hard to say what he's going to do, but he has been progressively taking a step in the right direction since returning from his injury. He had 6 tackles his first week back, had the bye week, 8 tackles his next week back, 9 the third week, which is why I don't recommend you bench him this week, just because he is showing that upside that Drew Tranquil had at the last season. But overall, yeah, Eric Kendricks is looking very good. And you would have actually lost points if you would have listened to me last week. I don't think this will be an every week thing, but either way, going forward, I definitely think you should keep Eric Kendricks in. And yeah, overall, that's pretty much my main advice if you are B-Dog, just because you're kind of stuck with my recommendations just because of how Antoine Winfield's already played. But either way, I would definitely recommend trying to find a trade partner with these linebackers. You could probably get some good value. Then we'll take a look at Scrambled and Wiggle Waggle, who I recommend you start Jeremiah Owusu-Koramoah and bench Jack Campbell. You can make a single argument for starting Jack Campbell at this point. 3 of his weeks were bad, 2 of which were mediocre, well, 3 of which were mediocre, and he's had one good week all season, which was sacrilegious. Yeah, this guy is, you could probably cut him if you're Scrambled and Wiggle Waggled. Hell, you could probably go trade for a linebacker from the last guy I was just talking about. This guy just really hasn't shown any signs of consistency. While at least Jeremiah Owusu-Koramoah might not be the most consistent guy in the world, at least he's shown that upside to be pretty good. It's way better than what you have with Jack Campbell. And especially if you're in a position where you're scrambled and you need to win games and you're kind of projected to lose by a lot, you definitely want to go for Jeremiah Owusu-Koramoah. Yeah, like I said, I do think Jack Campbell is pretty much cuttable at this point. The Lions are not using him nearly as much as I once thought they would at the beginning of the season. Now we'll get into the recommendations for the free agency side of things. My number one recommendation, Will Levis. Do I think he's going to necessarily go out there and be Tom Brady? No, I don't know what the fuck he's going to do. But for what it's worth, he has Derrick Henry, he has DeAndre Hopkins, he has Treylon Burks returning. He is being put into the best scenario this Titans offense has had all season, whether you're a Ryan Tannehill fan or not. And I understand their O-line's horrible, but it's still the best we've seen of this Titans offense since week one. And either you might say that Malik Willis might take away some of his snaps or might, you know, maybe even start over him. But in the at least Will Levis has that chance of having a good game and just straight up staying the starter for the rest of the season if he's able to manage that, and he does have upside. While the rest of the guys on free agency right now might have like another week left in them before they get put back on the bench because they're guys that they're subbing for, you know, going to get healthy. So this guy is definitely the number one option I'd recommend. I don't know how good he'll do, but at least he has upside to play. And then out of the other options that we do have for this specific week, it comes down to P.J. Walker and Tyrod Taylor. I would prefer Tyrod Taylor just because they were able to go out there, and even while only putting up 14 points against Washington, Tyrod Taylor was still able to go out there and get 2 touchdown passes. They got him to 27 points, 279 yards. He has rushing upside. I think I prefer him over Walker, to say the least. Plus, Tyrod Taylor does have Saquon. He can always dump the ball off to if he really needs to. So, yeah, I definitely prefer Tyrod Taylor. It is a tough matchup against the Jets, but I do think he'll outperform P.J. Walker, though. Then we'll go ahead and take a look at the running back side of things here. I would first of all recommend Jamal Williams, who I can't promise you guys is actually going to be good or anything like that, but he does have the touchdown upside if he were to go out there and start doing what he did in Detroit and be a touchdown hawk. So compared to what's on free agency right now, that is fucking way better than anything on free agency for the most part right now. So at least he has the upside. So if you're desperate for a running back, this guy could go in there and be like an Ezekiel Elliott type player maybe. But you'd kind of need to hope a few cards go in your favor. And I'd also recommend Tyler Algier. I think I've recommended him in like every of the last start bench recommendation videos. Yeah, if Bijan were to ever go down, this guy would instantly become a running back one. For right now, he is getting the rushing volume to at least go out there and get yards and receiving catches and potential touchdowns. At least he's getting the chance, even when he has to deal with Bijan. However, Cordero Patterson is coming in, and he's kind of getting thrown into the mix too. But either way, it's definitely better than everything else on free agency. Everything on free agency with these running backs is kind of ass, I'm not going to lie. Then we'll look at the receivers. Things are really starting to get to the bottom of the barrel here, fellas, I'm not going to lie. But the first receiver I'd recommend is Juju Smith-Schuster. Now, with Juju, he's not a great option. Hell, he's not even looking good. But for what it is worth, with Juju, he had two disappointing weeks to kick off the season against Philadelphia and against Miami. Then he played against three really tough matchups with good corners and good defenses all around the board, where he played the Jets, Cowboys, and Saints, where he had about 3, 4, and 1.5 points. So those didn't look too good, but those were probably some of the worst matchups he could have had. And then he did get hurt, so he's been out for a few weeks. Now he's going in there, and he does have some favorable matchups here. These are going to be the first time all season he's actually going to have decent matchups. So I'd say give him a look, at least pay attention to the guy, because maybe he actually has that upside to go out there and do good on these matchups for every week. Because keep in mind, he is a solid receiver. It's just a matter of Mac Jones is just kind of horrible at finding open receivers. So if he's able to get it done against, say, like weaker pass defenses, maybe he at least has upside. I'm kind of grasping at straws here because, yeah, there's really not many good players, like I said, on this free agency when it comes to a lot of these positions. Next up, we'll go ahead and look at Rondale Moore. With Rondale Moore, I'm mostly recommending taking a look at him, not because of the stats he's put up, but because of the return of Kyler Murray. Even though Dobbs hasn't been horrible, the return of Kyler Murray is going to drastically elevate everyone on this offense in terms of fantasy. And for what it's worth, Moore hasn't been horrible for most of the weeks. He's had a few solid weeks, but with the return of Kyler Murray, I do think he'll suddenly start having some good games. You know, I think he'll get more consistent overall. I can't promise it, but this is another guy that I'd say at least keep an eye out for. In years past, whenever it was just Marquise Brown and Rondale Moore was known to put up 20-plus points every other week. So keep an eye on this guy. He could actually have the upside there. Then we'll move on over to the tight ends. And we'll kick things off with Jonnu Smith. Jonnu Smith, since week 2, has had at least 7.7 points in each game. He's had at least 3 catches. He's been getting solid to good yards pretty much every game. He had a touchdown. He's getting targets, you name it. He's at least doing it. He's kind of stealing everything from Pitts. But when you want consistency, say you have a tight end on a bye week or a tight end who's hurt, if you're looking for consistency, look no further than Jonnu Smith. He's able to have those 8-point games, and on the weeks he's able to steal a touchdown, there you go, he has 14 points. He hasn't really shown any signs of slowing down. It's hard to trust a guy like this, but for what it's worth, he's been proving everyone wrong so far. And yeah, I definitely recommend him. I would also recommend Luke Musgrave. Luke Musgrave, we've only seen about 5 games of him. He had a bad week 4, bad week 2, but... Oh, it's about 6 games, my bad. He hasn't shown too much crazy upside, but he has shown the ability to get around a good 10 points per game. He's had a few games where he's had 6 catches in the game. I think Aaron Jones coming back could help him. It's hard to say for sure, but for what it's worth, I do think he'll have some upside, especially compared to a lot of these tight ends. Literally nobody on these tight ends, you could like look through all of them if you really care to. There is nobody out of these tight ends that have any sort of upside. I think Musgrave is just the best option, to be honest. It's really hard to make an argument for a lot of these guys, to be honest, because, yeah, they're just all ass. Then we'll go ahead and look at kicker. First of all, we'll look at Chris Boswell. I would recommend taking a look at Boswell, who's had a mediocre to a good week every single week since week 1. The Steelers are known for kicking a lot of field goals. They can occasionally get touchdowns. They're going to be missing Pat Freiermuth, who is probably their number one red zone guy. So I do think it's going to be field goal central for these Steelers going forward. And look at that schedule when it comes to teams that allow points to kickers. It's looking very good for Boswell. I definitely think he'll be one of the better free agents out there when it comes to the kicking game. And then I would also recommend you take a look at Jason Myers. Jason Myers has more upside than Boswell, I'll say that right now. If he can stop missing all of his fucking kicks, which he appears to have done, then he should be one of the better kickers in all of fantasy. You've seen it where outside of the weeks where he's been missing kicks and shit like that, or the fluke week against the Giants, he'll probably have a good 10 to 20 points every single week. He was one of the guys that was actually competing with Daniel Carlson and Justin Tucker in the last season for most points in the season. He was a very good option. Unfortunately, at the start of this season, he had a bad few weeks, which have kind of soured the pot on him, but he definitely has a lot of upside. Then we'll look at the defensive line position. First of all, I'd recommend taking a look at Jonathan Allen. This guy definitely has the good upside here. He had two bad weeks. He had a mediocre week. But other than that, he has great upside every single week to get sacks. He's one of the better defensive tackles in the entire league. He's known for doing really good. Now, here's the part where you should really pay attention to this guy if you need D-line. If Chase Young or Montez Sweat, especially Chase Young, if these players get traded to another team, you've seen it time and time again in history where when Jonathan Allen was the number one defensive tackle in Washington, while like guys like Chase Young or Montez Sweat were out, Jonathan Allen all of a sudden skyrocketed when it came to fantasy. Was one of the better options in all of fantasy for those games where those people were out. So I definitely recommend taking a look at Jonathan Allen if the Commanders end up trading Chase Young. And right now it's looking like I'd say the odds of them actually doing it are like 3 out of 4. The Commanders really are looking like they want to trade him away. So that's very good news for Jonathan Allen. I definitely recommend giving him a good look. And then I also would recommend... I don't even know how to pronounce that dude's name. Yeah, I do. It's Justin Madueke. And Justin Madueke has not had a single... Well, he did have one bad game so far this season, but the consistency is there. He's getting tackles. He's getting sacks. He's pretty much doing solid around the board. What can I say? I think he's the number one scoring defensive lineman on free agency right now. This guy is looking like hell. He'd probably be a good starter for almost everyone's team. So I definitely recommend this guy if you're looking for a consistent defensive lineman. Then we'll go ahead and look at the defensive backs. We'll look at the defensive backs first of all. We'll look at Kirby Joseph, who missed a few weeks throughout the early part of the season, but he has shown to have a decently high floor while also having some good upside on every given week. I do think he'll go out there and have really good weeks. I'm looking happy at the fact that he had 10 total tackles. This is his first year as a starter, if I'm not mistaken. He was a rookie last season. I do think Kirby Joseph's going to go out there. He's going to have a lot of tackles. I think he'll improve as the season goes on, kind of like Eric Kendricks. Just keep an eye on this guy. I do think he'll be pretty good. Then I'll also recommend you take a look at Ricardo Neal, who already played. With Ricardo Neal, this guy has looked really fucking good around the board outside of the week against New Orleans. I do think he's at the point where he's proven to have some safe floor while also having some pretty good upside. He's making plays left and right. He's getting tackles. He's getting tackle assists. That's pretty much what he's known for. He's getting a lot of those. In real life, this guy sucks. In fantasy, he's really good because he sucks and he gets blown in coverage and then makes tackles from it. So overall, I definitely recommend Ryan Neal. Plus, like I said in one of my past videos, I think it was the one I just released actually thinking about it. The Buccaneers corners have been struggling this season specifically, which struggling corners usually means good thing for safeties because they usually end up having to go make the tackle. So that's usually a good thing for safeties, and I do recommend looking at Ricardo Neal. And there is one bonus pick I'll recommend you guys take a look at because I did pretty much spend the season saying to ignore this guy and to cut him, and that's Jonathan Owens. Because, of course, the very first week that Evan cuts Jonathan Owens, their safety that was starting over Jonathan Owens decides he's going to go on injured reserve. Do I know for sure Jonathan Owens is going to go out there and be a top safety in the league? No, I cannot tell you that for sure. But for what it's worth, last season in Houston, whenever he was taking over for their starting safety, I forget who it was, he was one of the top safeties in the entire league along with Jalen Petre. And yeah, in the games he played, he would get like 15 to 20 to sometimes even 30 points in a game just out of tackles. I don't know how he's going to fit in with Green Bay. I can't tell you how all of this is going to go out, but it is being expected that he's going to have an expanded role. So at least keep an eye on this guy because he definitely has some very good upside that is a very sneaky guy in all these free agents right now. Next up, we'll take a look at linebacker. My first recommendation would actually be Drew Tranquil. Nick Bolton is now going on injured reserve. I would recommend going for Drew Tranquil, who is probably going to start being more established on this defense, going to start becoming more of a playmaker, more of a tackler overall. So I definitely recommend Drew Tranquil, especially since Bolton's out. He hasn't shown the insane upside he's had in last season's preview or showing. But for what it's worth, he hasn't been bad in the games where he's been playing. He's had at least 10 points every week since Nick Bolton got hurt at the end of week two. I definitely think worst case scenario, you have a guy who's going to get around 10 points per game. Best case scenario, you start to find that ridiculous upside he's had in last season. So overall, I definitely recommend taking a look at Drew Tranquil because he can be known for getting sacks. He's known for being a big rusher when it comes to being a middle linebacker. And then I'd also recommend Devin Lloyd. Devin Lloyd, we've only had a 4-game sample size, or a 5-game sample size, but for what it's worth, we do have 3/5 of those games being really good games, and the 3 that weren't, or the 2 that weren't really good games, were still okay. Now, I can't answer why he's so inconsistent when it comes to this. He's always had that issue, but if he is able to start being consistent with those 17, 18-point weeks, he could be like another Jermaine Pratt, but for the Jaguars, where he has the upside that's enough to argue him to be a startable player every week. Like I said, I can't answer why he sometimes does good and sometimes does bad. There's really no factor that I've been able to find that tells me to start him or don't start him on any given week. I think it's just kind of luck-based at this point. I don't know why the Jaguars do that. Hell, you even see what I'm talking about, where they played the Colts twice this season. One game he did really good, one game he really didn't. It's fucking luck. I don't know what to tell you on why he does this. But if he's able to start figuring out that consistency, as you saw with these past 2 weeks and week two, he could be a really fucking good option. So keep an eye on this guy. I do think he definitely has good upside, but if he just needs to get that consistency figured out over there. And I'm actually not going to be uploading clips for this video, just because I do want to upload this video as soon as possible so people have as much time as possible to set their teams up for the game, the games tomorrow. And setting all these clips do actually take quite a bit of time. So I do just think I'm going to pass on it for this one video just so people do have time to go through everything like I said. And I'm also going to be working on the transactions video. I'll probably release that either at some point tomorrow night or Monday morning, or maybe not morning, but Monday at some point. But either way, I do think I'll probably have it done by tomorrow night, either way. And then I'm going to still talk to Pussy about when we can get into the team defensive, or not team defense, the individual defensive rankings videos. And then I've already made my lists for the draft videos. I just got to figure out a good time to release those videos. I was planning on releasing it after I caught up with these videos I've fallen behind on. I've just been very busy over this past week overall. I apologize for being late over these past few weeks, but either way, I hope you guys enjoyed. I hope you guys got something useful out of this video, and I'll see you guys tomorrow for the videos, what went down. Good luck in your matchups, everybody, and I'll see you tomorrow.